For anyone who has any interest at all in navigating, whether that's walking around the hills, flying in an aeroplane, or sailing on a ship, or whatever, this is a really big deal. This morning, 2nd of January 25, the UK Ministry of Defence issued a press release which announced that some Royal Navy ships would begin testing a new way of finding your location. And this doesn't rely on GPS. It's called quantum navigation. As most people haven't heard of this before, I thought I'd make this short video to explain what quantum navigation is and how it works. And I appreciate that this is where some people will stop listening, because the word quantum normally sounds too complicated. But don't worry, on this channel, I always try and keep things as simple as I possibly can. The word quantum is quite simple itself. It comes from Latin and it just means how much. In physics, it's used in all sorts of ways. But for quantum navigation, the key idea is if you can measure how much something has changed very precisely, you can use that information to find out where you are. And in this case, we're measuring the waveform of a large number of atoms. But don't forget, we're going to keep this really simple. So today we'll say that an atom's waveform is, how can I put it? It's a tiny ripple or vibration that shows how it moves and where it might be. If you think back to your school days, you'll remember that most things are made of atoms, and these are just tiny particles that they're always moving. The faster they move, the more energy they have, which just for today, only for today, you can think of as the temperature. So to cool down atoms, we need to slow them down. And surprisingly, you can do this using lasers. Now, I understand that most people would think of lasers as being very hot, but they can actually cool atoms down by slowing them down. Lasers are just, they're beams of light made of tiny particles called photons, and these travel in waves. How those waves appear depends on whether something is moving towards or away from the laser. This is because of something called the Doppler effect. It's like how a siren sounds higher pitched as it moves towards you and lower as it goes away. It's the same sound waves, but you hear them differently depending on whether the source is coming towards you or the source is moving away from you. For atoms moving towards the laser, the light appears to have just the right Doppler effect, as the light waves are squished together, if you know, is that a good way, squished? And it looks to be just the right color or frequency for the atom to absorb. When the photon of light hits an atom, it gives it a tiny push, which over time and over, you know, lots of photons, it slows the atom down. It's a special kind of laser, and it's tuned to a frequency that mainly affects atoms moving towards the beam. The photon that's absorbed is later expelled, but this doesn't slow down the slowing down process. Since atoms move randomly in all directions, lasers are shined from multiple directions, so the atom is slowed down regardless of which direction it's traveling in. Remember, an atom's movement is what gives it energy. So if you can slow it down enough, it can be cooled to a temperature which is just above absolute zero. Then the cooled atoms are trapped inside a vacuum chamber using magnetic fields. As they cool further, the atoms merge into a unique state called, I'm not sure how to put this, I don't want to call it a Bose-Einstein condensate. That's just a bunch of atoms which are in a super cooled state. That'll do. I'll call it a bunch of atoms. Every physicist in the world now is shouting at their screens, "You can't say that." Well, today we are. Today I have officially renamed the Bose-Einstein condensate to a bunch of atoms. Anyway, in this state, atoms behave like one big superatom, making them incredibly predictable and precise. And this superatom behaves like a particle and also a wave. And don't forget, it's being held in place by a magnetic field. And then another type of laser is fired at it, and it splits it in two, our bunch. And the two parts of the bunch move away in opposite directions. Later on, the two parts are brought back together again. And here's the cool part, as this is how quantum navigation works. Imagine being in a moving car. When the car turns left, you feel a push to the right. When the car slows down, you feel a push forward. And it's the same thing, well, sort of, that happens to the two parts of the bunch of atoms, which are being held inside this vacuum container. The container moves, turns, accelerates, etc. And as the two parts of the atom, the bunch of atoms are traveling in opposite directions, the motion of the container affects them differently. When the two parts of the bunch of atoms are brought back together again, their waveforms combine and they form a new pattern in the waveform of the superatom. This pattern it's got a slightly different frequency or phase to what it had before the split, before it was cut in two. And this depends on the motion of the container. Don't forget that an atom's waveform is a tiny ripple or vibration. But as we now have a big bunch of atoms all acting in exactly the same way, the ripple or vibration is also much bigger. So it's easier to measure. By carefully measuring the difference between the original and the new waveform, it's possible to calculate the bunch of atoms' movement, its motion, acceleration, direction, etc., with extraordinary precision. So how does this help us to know where we are and where we're going? Well, if you know where you are and you measure the acceleration and direction over time, you can calculate your new position. It's like tracking every step that you take to map out where you'll end up. I'll give you an example. If I go north at a speed of 1 mile an hour, after 15 minutes, assuming that I set off at and I maintained exactly 1 mile an hour, I'll be 440 yards north of my starting position. How simple is that? Also, if you know where you want to go, the machinery holding the bunch of atoms, this could be connected to the steering mechanism on a car or an aeroplane or a ship, or for somebody walking around the hills. A line can be drawn on a map on your phone screen, and this will guide you precisely to your destination. Or you could set it so that it will give you a warning if you're heading off in the wrong direction, etc. This isn't just some crazy scientist coming up with yet another mad idea. Quantum navigation already works. So is this the end of our reliance on these, on GPS and the entire GPS system? I would say no. Well, not yet anyway. The reason for this is that at the moment, the machinery required is quite large, and it also needs a lot of maintenance. So it's really only possible to use it for now on something big, you know, a train or a ship or an aeroplane. But eventually, all the parts required, you know, which make quantum navigation possible, will be able to be stamped or printed onto a silicon chip. And then your phone will be able to, at last, to navigate without using old-style microwaves transmitted down from orbiting satellites. And the best thing is that quantum navigation can't be hacked. It can't be jammed. You know, the reason for this is it relies on the electromagnetic force, which is one of the four fundamental forces in the universe. So it will always be exactly accurate. For hill walkers and trekkers, quantum navigation will work in a forest or when it's snowing. It'll work for other people, it'll work in space or in a tunnel, on the moon, underwater. But the final question has to be, will it stop people getting lost? No. That's what you need a map and a compass for. Anyway, time for another cup of tea, because it's getting really cold out here. Oh, while we're here, don't forget, there is no excuse for going out anywhere with lazy sandwiches. So today, I'll show you what we've got today. I'm looking forward to this. Today we have, oh, look at this. we have roast chicken, there we go, roast chicken, pesto, black olives and rocket. I mean, this is what you need on a day like this. Anyway, thanks for watching. I'll have my sandwich and my tea now. A Bose-Einstein condensate gets its name from two physicists, Sietjandra Bose and Albert Einstein, who worked out the theory behind it. In the 1920s, Sietjandra Bose figured out some interesting things about particles of light that are called photons. He found that certain kinds of particles, which are now called bosons, they behave differently from other particles, like electrons. Instead of avoiding each other, bosons can group together and share the same state. Albert Einstein took Bose's ideas and he applied them to atoms. He predicted that under extremely cold conditions, certain atoms, the ones that are bosons, they would all settle into the exact same state. And this would create a completely new type of matter, where the atoms act like one big superatom instead of individual particles. This is special as at temperatures just above absolute zero, these atoms stop behaving like separate particles and merge into a single quantum state. This means that they all move together and they act as if they were just one entity with some really strange properties, like behaving both like a wave and a particle. So it's called the Bose-Einstein condensate because of the statistics which Bose discovered, and this explains how bosons behave. And Einstein expanded on this idea to predict this new state of matter. A condensate is just when particles, they condense into one shared state. In the lab in the 1990s, scientists, they actually created a Bose-Einstein condensate in, I think in 1995, using rubidium atoms. And these were cooled to near absolute zero. And this confirmed the ideas that Bose and Einstein came up with in the 1920s. Oh, just one thing. I said that Einstein worked out that, what did I say? Certain atoms, the ones that are bosons, would all settle into the exact same state. Now, probably not from school, but if you studied basic physics at college, you know, at college level, you'll remember that the reason that some atoms are bosons is because their total spin, which don't forget is a quantum property, is an integra, 0, 1, or 2. This happens when the combined spins of their protons, neutrons, and electrons, they add up to an integra, or an integra value. And it's this that allows them to follow the Bose-Einstein statistics and occupy the same quantum state. I think I'll delete this, because nobody's it. This is just waffle. I'm interested in this, but I know that nobody else is. So this will be deleted.